Dajit Cademila Falcha, welcome to Irish Granny Tarot. Saturday, time for our book. Before I start, I want to welcome Falcha, all my new subscribers, and a gigantic thank you to Linda G. It was so much fun to talk with her. I hope, you know, that you'll be able to find the time to watch my conversation with her. She's a hoot. I knew she would be. She's so much fun. My cheeks hurt from smiling when I ended that video. Perfect. And boy, talk about just a wonderful person. I have such respect for her. And I feel honored that she was willing to come and talk to me. She's a very generous person. She does that for anyone who asks. She's absolutely wonderful. So enough about how much I love Linda G. I just want to welcome new subscribers and thank you to all the brave souls who keep coming back for more. I'm so grateful. So I've got a good one for you this week. If you've listened to Al Franken's podcast, he has a funny little thing he does where he discusses the topic and the person he's going to interview every week. And he says, well, we've got a great one for you this week for a change. It's pretty cute. So that's what I'm going to say, because I'm always praising the books. I guess I like them or I wouldn't pick them out. So this is a great book. I read this book. It came out in 1992, and I read it when it first came out, and I was new to the whole notion that mainstream history and archaeology, academia, might be ignoring evidence, might be wrong, and sometimes intentionally. I was shocked by this book, found it fascinating, and the beauty of it is, I should show you the book, The Sign and the Seal by Graham Hancock, The Quest for the Lost Ark of the Covenant. Graham Hancock is a wonderful writer. He has just the most engaging style, and I don't feel I'm going to be able to do it justice. It's been so easy to read this book. Now, I'm not going to get through the whole book today. It, as you can see, check it out. It's a huge book, and I'm halfway through because there's quite a lengthy bibliography and references and footnotes and that kind of thing that take up some of the density of it, but it's well written, entertaining, engaging. I gloss over many areas where he describes scenery, settings, descriptions of people. We'd never get through the book, and he does a beautiful job. He paints such a vivid picture. I recommend this book, and I recommend all of his books. I may have to do another one of his books in the near future if everybody likes this one. So let's just get right into it. It connects in an odd way. I mean, isn't it mysterious how these books all sort of present themselves in a recognizable, logical order? So the book that we did a couple of weeks ago, The Dawn of Everything, sort of introduced us to the idea that questioning mainstream conventional experts in areas like archaeology and anthropology and history, that it's not so revolutionary to question them, that there actually is overwhelming evidence that's been ignored or marginalized, sidelined, and often destroyed. Although there are records of many of these things that have been lost to time. And it's, I feel a little dangerous in these days of enormous conspiracy theories to even dive into something like this. And he's not a conspiracy theorist. He's an intelligent man with a lot of experience, both in the politics, contemporary events, current events at the time, and geography of the area of which he speaks, and globally as well. He's really well educated. So he's not the kind of person that's prone to just throwing out, you know, mainstream academia and ignoring it. it lends some credence to the possibility that these things, you know, there's the potential there may be a thread of truth. And this book connects to that premise that was introduced to us in The Dawn of Everything, and then Joseph Farrell's book after that, Giants, Gods, Monsters, and Men, which I noticed the other day I wrote the title wrong on one of my videos. I think he'll forgive me. These books are not afraid to question convention, which is probably why I like them. I'm kind of a troublemaker. So let's get into it. The Sign and the Seal, 1992, by Graham Hancock. And I should say a little bit about Graham Hancock. He was the East African correspondent for The Economist. He also was, he's still alive, but he also was the author of a lot of books and publications, not always full books. And as you'll see, he ended up doing some writing for the government of Ethiopia. So part one, this was written in 92, but it's based on starting with the time that he was working for The Economist and traveling extensively in coastal Eastern Africa. And he was in Ethiopia on an assignment. And we are talking about 1983. The title of this part of the book, part one, is Ethiopia 83, The Legend. And chapter one is Initiation, 1983. This is his introduction to this whole area, something he never dawned on him. So the local language of the area he was visiting is called Tigrinya, and I'm probably mispronouncing it. And the book starts with a visit to a monk, a very old, bearded, toothless monk with cataracts, and his description of him is delicious. And this little bit right here is in the larger context, and we will go later to what started this visit. So Hancock is in front of a building, and he says to this old man, I've heard that you have this Ethiopian tradition that the Ark of the Covenant is in this chapel behind you, and you're the guardian. Is that true? And the old man said, yes, this is true. And Graham Hancock then says to him, and I was hoping to get to this sooner today, but I was pleasantly delayed responding to comments. It took much longer than I expected. I was hoping to get started before darkness fell here in the Great White North. So Hancock responds to this monk. Let me be clear about this. Are you referring to the original Ark of the Covenant, the box made of wood and gold in which the Ten Commandments were placed by the prophet Moses? And the monk says, yes, God himself inscribed the 10 words of the law upon 2 tablets of stone. Moses placed these tablets inside the Ark of the Covenant, which afterwards accompanied the Israelites during their wanderings in the wilderness and their conquest of the Promised Land. It brought them victory wherever they went and made them a great people. At last, when its work was done, King Solomon placed it in the Holy of Holies of the Temple, the first temple, that he had built in Jerusalem. And from there, not long afterwards, it was removed and brought to Ethiopia. So now the mystery begins. So Graham Hancock digs further into this story, and it goes that the Queen of Sheba, who the Ethiopians claim was Ethiopian, not the prevailing archaeological belief, but we'll see the arguments pro and con. The Queen of Sheba went to Jerusalem, and in Jerusalem, she conceived a child by King Solomon. This child was a boy, and his name was Menelik. Menelik, at the age of 20, returned to Israel. I mean, Queen of Sheba, pregnant, went back, you know, had her baby, took the baby, went back to Ethiopia. So at the age of 20, he went back, and he was received with honors. So because King Solomon was so happy to honor his son, elders, other people around the king got very jealous and resented the fact that he was favored, and they wanted him to go back home to Ethiopia. Solomon said, okay, but if I send my firstborn son to Ethiopia, your firstborn sons have to accompany him as a guard, a protective guard. And they have to go with him, and they have to stay with him in Ethiopia. So the high priest Zadok had a son by the name of Azurias, and Azurias stole the ark. This is the Ethiopians' lore, their traditional story. Menelik, Solomon's son, didn't realize that this had happened until they were too far from Jerusalem to go back and return it. So he justified the situation by reassuring himself that God must have had a hand in this, and it belonged in Ethiopia because it was God's will, and it's been in Ethiopia ever since. And the old man said to Graham Hancock, I know the nature of the object that has been placed in my care. So Graham Hancock speculates in this book. He asks himself a few questions. Why and how did this monk become a guardian of anything? Was he nominated by his previous predecessor, as the myth goes? The dying guardian appoints the next guardian. His job is to pick his successor with the love of God, the successor would have the love of God, the purity of heart, and the cleanliness of mind and body. And the monk tells Graham Hancock, I alone may see it. No one else is allowed to see it. In the distant past, it had been brought out in the sight of other people during important church festivals. Now it's only brought out once a year on the day of Timkat, the Epiphany, which is in January. And we'll get into it a little more later, but since I read it yesterday and I kind of remember it, in the Ethiopian Christian Orthodox Church, Timkat does not honor, doesn't consider the Epiphany the same as the Roman Church, which was the Magi, the gift of the Magi. Christ is presented to the world as an infant, I believe 7 days after his birth. No, it's January 8th. I don't know. It's a while after. It's not like he was born on Christmas Day. So Timkat for the Ethiopian Orthodox Church is the feast of the baptism of Christ. And it's the biggest festival, religious festival, in the Ethiopian Church. But the ark, when it's brought out, it has to be completely wrapped so it can't be seen, and it has to have a certain kind of very thick cloth, and it's to protect, not to keep it from being viewed, but to protect the laity, the people who are not special, from the power of the ark, which we're going to get into eventually. In the Old Testament times, the Israelites worshipped the ark itself as the embodiment of God. They called it the sign and the seal of his presence on earth, as the stronghold of his power, and as the instrument of his ineffable will. Hence the title. Let's see here. It was built to contain the tablets of stone upon which the Ten Commandments had been written. It was a wooden chest measuring 3 feet 9 inches long by 2 feet 3 inches high and wide. It was lined inside and out with pure gold and was surmounted by 2 winged figures of cherubim that faced each other across its heavy golden lid. Biblical and other archaic sources speak of the ark blazing with fire and light, inflicting cancerous tumors and severe burns, leveling mountains, stopping rivers, blasting whole armies, and laying waste cities. The same sources also leave no doubt that it was for a very long time the cornerstone of the evolving Jewish faith. Indeed, when King Solomon built the first temple in Jerusalem, his sole motive was to create, quote, a house of rest for the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. At some unknown date between the 10th and 6th century BC, however, this uniquely precious and puissant object vanished from its place in the Holy of the Holies of that temple. It vanished without song or lamentation in the scriptures, almost as though it had never existed at all. The evidence suggests that it was already long gone when the armies of Nebuchadnezzar, sorry about that, burned Jerusalem in 587 BC. Certainly, it was not in the second temple, which was built over the ruins of the first after the Jews had returned from their exile in Babylon in 538 BC. Neither does it seem to have been taken as booty by the Babylonians. But the point that he makes throughout this book is that the Ark was said to have unbelievable powers, that it killed people who got too close. It was used as a weapon of war. It had a power that people were afraid of. And then there are pictures, lots of photographs in this book. You know, I love a book that has pictures. And with the big angels over it. I mean, the Ark, I don't know. When I think of the Ark, only because I mean, I know better because we learned it in school, but you know you forget. Whenever someone says Ark, I always think of the whatchamacallit on the altar in a Catholic church where the consecrated host goes, the tabernacle. I always think of that. But actually the Ark, you know, it was big. And the reason he gives the measurements is it matters. It matters later. So this disappearance was mysterious, and it goes completely unremarked in the Bible. It's like the Ark is there one day. It's awesome. It's powerful. It's revered. It's the most holy of holy things. It's in the Holy of Holies. And then, boom, it's gone. It's the most important object in the world in the biblical view, and it simply ceases to exist in the story. It's one of the great mysteries of the Bible. There are more than 200 references in the Bible to the Ark up until about 970 to 931 BC, the time of Solomon, and then nothing. It's an historical enigma that such a religiously significant object should go missing with a completely deafening silence. And he asks, well, why? Was there some sort of cover-up? What's going on here? This is a genuine mystery. It has inspired several treasure hunts. I did see the movie, The Raiders of the Lost Ark, but I don't remember anything about it at all except some big stone chasing, what's his name, Harrison Ford. Probably had small children. I don't remember a thing about it. But this movie kind of reflects some of this story, not all of it, and we're not delving into Hollywood stuff here. This is all got archaeological and historical evidence attached. So Hancock went to Tigray in Ethiopia in 1983 to the city of Aksum. At the time, the Tigray People's Liberation Front, the TPLF, was a small guerrilla force. Later, it took over the government, but it besieged the city, but the city at the time that he was there was still in government hands. He was the first foreigner to go to that city since 1974, when teams of British archaeologists had gotten kicked out by a revolt against Haile Selassie that installed the bloody dictator, Colonel Mengistu Haile Mariam. So the colonel bad, apparently. The rebels coming up seemed to be fighting against this dictator and his abuses. And Haile Selassie, I think he had the weight of history and reverence on his side from the people. And if I'm not mistaken, there's a connection here with the Rastafarian religion and Haile Selassie. They sing about Zion. This is what they're singing about. I should have looked it up, but I got distracted. So Hancock was working for Mengistu, the colonel, the bad guy. And he said he would later bitterly regret that he had contracted officially to make a coffee table book about Ethiopia. And Mengistu wanted to show the unity of the country's cultural diversity and to emphasize the historical importance of the boundaries that the rebels were trying to redraw. And at the time, Hancock, when he made the agreement, he didn't realize that there was a political reason for this book. He thought it was a cultural thing that he was doing and really regretted, but then it was too late to get out of it. And he actually ended up doing some more work for the colonel, but in a very pragmatic way. He realized this guy was evil, but he also realized that if he was going to pursue this story, he needed a connection within the government. He had to play it both ways a little bit. So he felt conflicted about this. This search for information challenged his sense of morality, but it's a great story. So the colonel wanted to show how diverse and culturally united the country was, which couldn't be farther from the truth at the time. So Hancock had this contract, and he said that the contract said the book would be apolitical and it wouldn't praise or critique any individual, but that's not how it ended up being. Hancock was aware that the big shots in the regime were letting him see forbidden historical sites and archaeological sites because they thought that this would polish their image on a global stage. He needed to fly over battle lines from Eritrea to get to Aksum to do the research for this book, and this description of this flight is terrifying. It really is. So the city of Asmara had been an Italian colonial stronghold from 1889 to 1950. And just a little aside, because I can't help but distract myself, the Italians were fabulous archaeologists in all different sorts of places where they ought have been digging around. And one of those places was Ethiopia, because they were colonizing it. And in the National Archaeological Museum of Italy, and it's been so long since I practiced my Italian, I'm not even going to insult you all by butchering it in Italian. It's really pretty. The museum is about 5 stories of archaeological riches, just phenomenal. They have the greatest Egyptian collection outside Cairo. But I had forgotten about this. They also have stuff from Ethiopia, too. And fascinating. So they were there from 1889 to the 1950s. And he says the city of Asmara has this Italian feel. It's very Latin feeling, very Mediterranean. And he describes the villas and the gardens and the flowers. He says it's like being in Italy. He said that he noticed that there was this Cuban Russian military presence there. They were there as advisors. He says they were strutting around in their uniforms with big guns, looking pretty arrogant. And it was an intimidating period of time to be there. So in the hotel bar, because where else do you hang out in a war zone? In the hotel bar, he met 2 Zambian pilots. And they thought that they were signing up to do commercial flights for Ethiopia, but quickly discovered once their agreement was signed with this guy that nobody dared to cross, you know, the dictator, they discovered that what they were really doing was ferrying out injured soldiers from the war zone, and they were stuck at the contract, and they were really shaken up. They were scared to death. They dreaded flying every day, and they went to the bar every night and got drunk so they could sleep, but gives you supreme confidence. They were forced to carry far too many people at a time, all of them injured, some of them with horrible wounds, and the plane was often hit by machine gun fire flying into and out of the city and the war zone, and the runway was made of gravel and was too short, so they kind of have to drop out of the sky. I mean, it's harrowing. Aksum was the oldest and most important archaeological site in Ethiopia. It's where the Ethiopian Christian religion started, and it had been the capital before Addis Ababa for hundreds and hundreds of years. It's an ancient, ancient place. So Hancock was able to negotiate a ride with these pilots, these traumatized pilots, because they were scheduled to carry military brass to go inspect a garrison. So he managed to ride without a bunch of bleeding soldiers. So he gets to Aksum, and from AD 64, from a trading manual written by an anonymous Greek trader called Periplus of the Erythraean Sea, it spoke of a superior Aksum priest who spoke Greek. So this is an Ethiopian prince who actually also knew Greek. So right away we're getting a hint. There's ancient manuscript documentation that perhaps the Ethiopians weren't as isolated as modern day academics like to paint the picture. So hundreds of years later, the Julian the ambassador to the Justinian court, the Emperor Justinian, called Aksum the greatest city in all of Ethiopia. The king, he added, and this is a great description, so I hope you'll bear with me and be patient while I read this, because I could not do it justice by summarizing it. The king, he added, was almost naked, wearing only a garment of linen embroidered with gold from his waist to his loins, and straps set with pearls over his back and stomach. He wore golden bracelets on his arm, a golden collar around his neck, and on his head a linen turban also embroidered with gold, from which hung four fillets on either side. I believe they mean like strings of gold. When receiving the ambassador's credentials, this monarch apparently stood on a four-wheeled chariot drawn by four elephants. The body of the chariot was high and covered with gold plates. Just a remarkable description. In the 6th century AD, Indico Pleustes, was a Christian monk, and I'm sure he'll forgive me for mispronouncing it, and he had been to Aksum, and he said after his visit to the city, he reported that the four-towered palace of the king of Ethiopia was adorned with four brazen figures of a unicorn, as well as the skin of a rhinoceros stuffed with chaff. He also saw several giraffes which had been caught by command of the king when young and tamed to make a show for his amusement. Most important power between the Roman Empire and Persia was Ethiopia. Ethiopia had navies that they sent to Egypt, India, Ceylon, and China. So we're getting a picture here of Ethiopia as a really important global power at a time when people like to deny that that had even happened. They adopted the Christian religion as the state religion in the 4th century AD. And it was sort of developed there in the 4th century by the Byzantine theologian Rufinus. So here's a story that he wrote. Frumentius was one of two Syrian boys who were educated by Meripius, a Christian merchant and a philosopher of Tyre. On a trip home, back from India, they were attacked. Their ship was attacked, and Frumentius was made treasurer and secretary of the king of Aksum because he was so smart. And even after the king's death, he stayed on with the queen, and so the king died. He stayed on with the queen and her son and had a great influence on the politics of Ethiopia and attracted many Christian traders, which affected the culture. He went to Egypt and he asked the patriarch of Egypt, Patriarch Athanasius, to send a bishop for Ethiopia. And the patriarch said, well, how about you? And so they made Frumentius the bishop and they sent him back to Aksum. I suppose when you think about it, I suppose they figure nothing ventured, nothing gained. We'll make him the bishop and we'll send him, and maybe he'll have luck. And if he doesn't, we haven't wasted any of our important bishops. But it turned out that he was effective. He became the first Christian bishop of Ethiopia. He converted the king in 331 AD. And there are coins that were found from that time period, amongst the earliest coins from Ethiopia, and they have the symbol of the cross on them. So there are also older sites in Ethiopia, palaces and obelisks that are over 2,000 years old. And they are actually from discoveries that are the most advanced in the sub-Saharan Africa. When we say most advanced, I want to be really careful about this. We're not comparing Western culture to African culture and finding the Western culture most advanced. We're comparing Western culture to other Western archaeological sites and saying these are more advanced than the Western archaeological sites that you tout as being the epitome of advancement in Africa, because that's not true. Here's even older stuff in Ethiopia, and you're ignoring it. We're not getting into a lot of the African culture or archaeology, because that's not what this book is about. This book is about, I guess, Bible history, the archaeology, really, of biblical influences on Ethiopia. And just in case anybody doesn't know, I'm not Christian, and I'm not pushing this from that sort of fundamentalist point of view. I'm very interested in history and archaeology, as is Graham Hancock. He is also, I wouldn't describe what his belief system is, but to say that this book is unaffiliated. It's unaffiliated with a religious belief. It's an historical mystery adventure, is the best way to describe it. So we've established that. So there are these older sites that are even 2,000 years old. And this is where the mention of the Ark happens for the first time in Ethiopia. And it's dismissed as fiction by historians, modern day historians. And Hancock said, well, why don't I check it out? So he describes this terrifying, scary corkscrew landing to avoid gunfire and the short runway. And he says there's huge, heavy artillery and trenches lining the runway, and Soviet tanks, and a couple of Mi-24 helicopter gunships with rockets. And he was disconcerted. He was given one night to stay and met by the Ministry of Culture, well, a guy from the Ministry of Culture, who told him that he was sent to keep an eye on the antiquities of Aksum so that Hancock didn't walk off with any statues in his pocket. So this guy that was sent by the ministry actually had experience. He had worked with British archaeologists who'd been kicked out in 74, so he wasn't unaware of what was around. Hancock told the guide his agenda, that he wanted to see the Ark, and would that be possible? And the guy said, yeah, it was in town. So didn't expect it to be this easy. And obviously, from the length of the book, it wasn't. And he says, so where is it exactly? And the man says, it's deposited in a chapel near the center of the city. Hancock asks, is this chapel very old? The guy says, no, its construction was ordered by our late emperor in 1965, I think. That would be Haile Selassie. Before that, the relic had rested for many hundreds of years within the Holy of Holies of the nearby Church of St. Mary of Zion. Haile Selassie had a special interest in this matter, by the way. He was the 225th direct line descendant of Menelik, son of the Queen of Sheba and King Solomon. It was Menelik who brought the Ark of the Covenant to our country. I was all for visiting the chapel at once, but the guide persuaded me that there was little point in hurrying. You will not be allowed anywhere near the Ark. Where it rests is holy ground. The monks and the citizens of Aksum protect it, and they would not hesitate to kill anyone who tried to break in. Just one man is allowed to enter, and he is the monk responsible for guarding the Ark. Remember the old guy? We will try to meet him later today, but first let us go and see the Queen of Sheba's palace. Now, if you think this is going to be straightforward, guess again. Now we have another mystery. So they went to the Queen of Sheba's palace, and she has sometimes been called Makeda. This guide admits that they dug around in the 1960s and that they said, okay, well, this palace is not old enough to have belonged to the Queen of Sheba. But they did find the area of her burial in a field, and it was completely unremarked. It was not marked with a monument or an obelisk or a stone. Grass was growing over it, and in fact, the field was being planted with crops by two boys with oxen. But it's considered officially as where she was buried. So Hancock toured several other sites, forts, stelae, the pleasure baths of the Queen of Sheba, and this obelisks, including one that was 500 tons in weight and the largest single stone ever quarried in the ancient world. I would love to see that. It was huge, as you can imagine, and it was carved. An obelisk is like a big, long, thin pillar. And it was carved like a 13-story building. It was carved to look like a building with windows and lintels and definition between the floors. And at the bottom floor, there was a door with a knocker. I mean, it was just a relief. It was engraved into it. Where am I? It was so sophisticated that they thought, how has this happened? How did this happen? This is, acts them as a mystery. How are these things here? Because they don't coordinate with prevailing academic belief. He found a compound with two churches, one of them called St. Mary's. And the newer one, well, one of them was the old St. Mary's and the other was the new St. Mary's. And the newer one, built by Haile Selassie, was built in the 60s. It was really ugly. The older one was built by somebody called Fasilidis. It was half of a church and half of a castle. And it kind of emphasized the fact, reminded Hancock, who knew this already, that in Ethiopia, the religion and the military are like this. And this is really important. An organized, defined military, historically, from the time of the Queen of Sheba, has been closely associated with religion in Ethiopia. And there's a really interesting reason why, which we're going to get to. I have to tempt you. So this site was the site of the original St. Mary's of Zion in the 4th century AD. It was built as the earliest Christian church in Ethiopia. But in 1535, it was razed to the ground by Muslims because they were marching through Africa and Europe. And they threatened Ethiopian Christianity completely. There's a description from a Portuguese friar of the church before it was destroyed, like just a year or two before it was destroyed. This Portuguese friar, with whom we will have the opportunity to hear more, from whom we'll hear more. So this is a quotation from his writings. It was very large and has five naves of a good width and is of great length, vaulted above. And all the vaults, now keep in mind vaults are covered up and the ceiling and sides are all painted. It also has choir after our fashion. This noble church has a very large circuit paved with flagstones like gravestones. And it has a very large enclosure and is surrounded by another enclosure like the wall of a large town or city. And I'm going to make an assumption here. I don't remember from my reading, and if I'm wrong, I'll tell you. But a lot of these very early Christian churches were circular or multifaceted, but not rectangular or square. And they would be often concentric. And the Holy of Holies, the inner sanctum, was the center. And I didn't understand that as a child when I heard inner sanctum, and I thought it was someplace far off at the end of the church. No, it was in the center. So lay people, I guess you'd call them, could go to the outside, on the porches around, and then the next layer would be members of the church who weren't clergy, and then there'd be an inner sanctum for the clergy, and then there'd be the inner, the Holy of Holies. That would be where the ark or special relics, which we'll talk about, would have been kept. So the first St. Mary's was started in AD 372, and it was he repeats himself, so will I. The first sub-Saharan Christian church like that, very sophisticated. Remember the vaults? That's a Gothic thing. Very sophisticated by comparison to the time. So it was built to have, I'm confusing it with the second church. This is the early church, the 372 AD church. So pretend I didn't say that. Ignore it. So this first original St. Mary's of Zion, really old. This would be the more circular. Built in 372 to house the Ark. In 1520, Alvarez, the first European to document this Ethiopian version of what the church looked like, also the first one to tell Europeans the Ethiopian version of the story of the Queen of Sheba and Menelik, and the first to tell people that the Ark was believed to still be in the Holy of Holies. So in 1530s, there was an invasion by the Muslim army. The guy's name was Ahmed Gran, I think. And in 1535, there was looting and destruction of all of the town of Aksum. The Ark survived because it had been spirited away for safekeeping just before the town was sacked. And 100 years later, this is the Ethiopian belief, 100 years later, it was brought back to the second St. Mary's. And the second St. Mary's was a rebuilding of the ancient church that was destroyed by the Muslims. Not hating the Muslims, this is just history. And and so this ancient church was destroyed and it had to be replaced, and it was rebuilt by Fasilides over the ruins of the first church. This is an important fact because we're talking 1540s, 1550s. Keep that in mind, roughly. In 1965, it was moved by Selassie and then put in this new, ugly, more secure chapel that actually was annexed to the old one, just the old St. Mary's. And in the ground of this chapel, standing in the grounds of this chapel, the monk told Hancock a story. He warned Hancock that the Ark was powerful. "How powerful?" I asked. "What do you mean?" The guardian's posture stiffened, and he seemed suddenly to grow more alert. There was a pause, then he chuckled and put a question to me. "Have you seen the stelae?" "Yes," I replied, "I've seen them." They're sort of like tall, not as big as obelisks, but like needles of rock with inscriptions. "Yes," I replied, "I've seen them. So how do you think they were raised up?" I confessed I didn't know. "The ark was used," whispered the monk darkly. "The ark and the celestial fire. Men alone could never have done such a thing." Okay. That's interesting. So Hancock returned to Addis Ababa, the capital, and began his research. So now we start chapter 2, called Disenchantment. And in 1983, 9 years after the overthrow of Selassie, but 8 years after he was smothered by the lieutenant colonel, the dictator, I didn't know that, this is when this story for Hancock is happening. And during the 70s, this Colonel Mengistu had put the Red Terror onto people. These were the death squads that would go to houses and pull people out of their houses who were supporters of the Selassie monarchy. And they would kill them, and their family was not allowed to claim their body for burial until they paid for the bullets. So that gives you a sense of what this guy is like. Hancock started researching Selassie and the Solomonic dynasty. And he wasn't welcomed when he started poking into things. Selassie did claim 225, he was the 225th direct descendant in a straight line from Menelik, the son of the Queen of Sheba and Solomon. And very few Ethiopians doubted this, including academics, archaeologists. Ethiopians were very much agreeing with this. Mengistu believed it. And when he murdered Selassie, according to the Ethiopians, he took the ring that marked that line of inheritance off of Selassie's dead hand and put it on himself. Hancock said he tried to talk to people. Now, keep in mind, there's a war going on here. There's a civil war. There's a rebellion. These Tigrayan rebels are revolting against the dictator. So it's a mess. And most of his contacts were too terrified to talk about the Ark because of its association with monarchy and their fear of the colonel. And they were terrified to talk about Selassie. So then he had a friend who joined him from England, Professor Richard Pankhurst. Now that name might ring a bell. It did for me. I didn't know why, but I recognized it. Pankhurst was the grandson of the suffragette Emmeline Pankhurst and the son of Sylvia Pankhurst, who fought, this woman fought with the Abyssinian resistance against the Italian occupation of the 1930s. So some powerful women in this guy's life. And he happened to be the leading Ethiopian historian in the world. And he founded the Institution of Ethiopian Studies at Addis Ababa University during Selassie's reign. But in 74, he had to leave the country because of Selassie's overthrow. And he really wanted to return, obviously. So he started working on this book with Graham Hancock. He told him that the story of Solomon and Sheba was an ancient story and that there are many versions, oral and written, and that the oldest extant is from the 13th century, from a manuscript, to which we're going to refer often, called the Kebra Nagast. And this is considered true history by Ethiopians, but Pankhurst said that it couldn't be true because the land of Sheba is in Arabia, not Ethiopia. But the story may have some shards of truth in it. Ethiopia and Jerusalem were in contact with each other that early. And the Ethiopian culture shows a strong Judaic influence. This is where it gets really interesting. For example, there is a group, I don't know what else term to use, a subcultural group of Jews called the Black Jews of Ethiopia, called the Falasha. Now, these are indigenous native Ethiopian people who practice an archaic form of Judaism. Wait till you hear this. They have widespread customs that have to do with ancient Judaism, circumcision, the food laws from Leviticus. They keep a Saturday Sabbath in rural areas. They dress differently. Their dialect was different than the other indigenous people of the area. They practiced an extremely archaic form of Judaism. They kept many traditions that had been abandoned even millennia ago. They're given the right to claim that they're Jewish and the right to Israeli citizenship under the Israeli law of return. And the big question is, where did they come from? And of course, keep in mind that Ethiopia had its own paganistic beliefs, different sorts. It had this very unique, singular brand of Ethiopian Christian Orthodoxy, which is unlike other Christian groups. And now they're discovering they have this ancient practice of just archaic, long abandoned Judaism. So where did this come from? Did they migrate from Southwest Arabia, hence the myth of the Queen of Sheba from Arabia, claiming she was from Ethiopia? Were they converted from local people, or were they migrated and then descended? Was it a community of displaced Jews? There is the prevailing historical orthodoxy is that a community of displaced Jews from Jerusalem were chased out, escaping the Roman persecutions in Palestine in the first century AD, that they fled to Yemen, and that from Yemen they migrated slowly down the northeast of Africa and ended up in Ethiopia. The Falashas, however, say they are the descendants of Solomon, that he impregnated the Queen of Sheba, and he also impregnated her maidservant. We just won't even think about all of this. We'll just move on. He also impregnated her maidservant, and that was Menelik's half-brother. And he was the founder of the Falasha, and all the other Jews in Ethiopia were the descendants of the Jewish bodyguards that came with him from the firstborn of the elders sent by King Solomon and with the pilfered ark. So Pankhurst said no to the ark story. Axum didn't exist then. This is nonsense. It can't be true. Solomon died in 940, 930 BC, and therefore Menelik went to Axum about 950, 940 BC, you know, give or take. But Axum was built in the 3rd century BC, 700 or 800 years later. So this all happened way before Axum was a thing. Therefore, the story is wrong. Except the Ark may have been kept somewhere else before it was brought to the original city of Axum 800 years later. Some parts of the Falasha myth are historically true and can be shown to be historically true. So, is it all historically true because there's evidence that's ignored or hasn't been discovered? Let's find out. So, in the 15th and 16th century AD, the monarchical rulers of the Jews were a strong force against the Christians. And eventually, by the 18th century, so within 300 years, they were greatly reduced. And by 1983, there were only about 20,000 left, and they were all trying to go to Israel. So Hancock visited Bahar Dar, which is a small town on a little a lake called Lake Tana. And this is like an inland sea, and it is scattered with islands. And he describes trying to get a boat, and it's pretty hilarious, but it's a lengthy story, and I'll skip it. But read the book. It's a very good book. So he went in a boat through the reeds of this lake into the center of the lake to visit some of these small islands that have monasteries. There are about 20 of them. And he said these islands kind of rise up dramatically from the lake like mountains. They're tall islands. They actually have altitude. And they're extremely isolated. They have been used as safe havens during wars for art, manuscripts, cultural objects, relics, and the monks intend to keep isolation from the rest of the world. They have the old round churches in concentric areas at the center, the Holy of Holies, the inner sanctum, and only the senior priest could enter this inner sanctum. And what's kept in all these inner sancti are the things called the tabot, T-A-B-O-T. I don't know if it's tabot or tabot. I'll call it tabot. It sounds more Jewish. It's not even Jewish, but anyway. The word means ark. And let me describe what he has to say about this. It's very interesting. Every Orthodox church in Ethiopia had its own Holy of Holies, and in every Holy of Holies was a Tabat. No claim was made that any of these objects were actually the Ark of the Covenant. There is only one true Ark, and that properly is known as the Tabata Zion. And it had indeed been brought by Menelik to Ethiopia in the time of Solomon and now stood in the sanctuary chapel in Aksum. All the others throughout the length and breadth of the land were merely replicas of that sacred and inviolable original. These replicas, however, were important. Indeed, they were extremely important. Symbolic on several levels, it appeared from what I was told that they fully embodied the intangible notion of sanctity. As Abba Haile Mariam, the priest, painstakingly explained to me during our interview at this monastery, it is the tabats rather than the churches that they stand in that are consecrated. Without a tabat at its heart in its Holy of Holies, a church is just an empty husk, a dead building of no greater or lesser significance than any other. Why are Christian churches keeping the replica of a pre-Christian ark? He had no answer for this yet. And it has nothing to do with Jesus. So Hancock was told that he was not allowed to take pictures or talk to Falashas because of the dictator. With an absolutely straight face, he says, "This year, the position of our government is that the Falashas don't exist, and if they don't exist, then obviously you can't talk to any of them or take their pictures. It would be a contradiction." So he saw a Star of David in passing. They were driving, and he saw a Star of David on a house, you know, a very primitive house. And he tried to persuade his guide, he told this story. I'm trying to remember if I can remember the story. I didn't write it all down. But the guide said, "No, I'm not going to stop because I had been assigned to take a Canadian film crew and they had permission and everything else. And after I took them, I was arrested for facilitating anti-government propaganda. They had government permits." He says, "There's no way." So Hancock asked him, "Well, why are we supposed to say there are no Jews in Ethiopia?" And the guide explained, "Because the tension existed between the sects, the Falasha against the Amhara, the ethnic group. And those were the people in charge, the Amhara. And so they were pushing out the Falasha." Common story, right? And also, within the ruling elites, there was a contradiction. They didn't like international criticism of how the Falasha were being treated. Falasha, I think I wrote that. Falasha, yeah. I can't read my own writing. They didn't like how global criticism was falling on their heads, the elites, the Amhara, because they were mistreating the Falasha, marginalizing them. So the best thing to do is say they didn't exist. Also, Ethiopia had joined an African coalition to end relationships with Israel after the Arab-Israeli war. So there was that factor too. But Israel still provided military aid to the regime. And in return for the military aid, they were kind of buying the freedom of hundreds of Falashas, and they had gone to Israel. They were allowing them under the law of return. But thousands had fled to refugee camps in the Sudan, hoping to get to Tel Aviv that way. So, you know, this is the start, at least partially contributing to these terrible refugee camps in the Sudan. And the big shots in charge feared that it would look like they weren't in control, because they weren't. So Hancock and his companions camped in the mountains, and that's a miserable description. I'm sorry. This alone would turn me off of doing archaeology. They camped in the mountains. It was cold. It was uncomfortable. It was the middle of nowhere. But they saw scattered small settlements of grazing animals and cereal crops, and these were Amhara hamlets, just six houses to a hamlet. They were circular, wattle and daub, with conical thatched roofs. I bet you've seen pictures of them. They're really interesting. The women they met, He said they didn't meet men. The women that they met were very poor, but they acted proud because they were from the master race, the Amhara, who had ruled since AD 1270 till 1974. And Amharic was the country's language, and it's a really interesting language. And, you know, FYI, if you want to hear it spoken, I'm sure you can find it elsewhere, but I got to hear it spoken on that show, 90 Day Fiancé. This young woman ended up in Ethiopia, ended up marrying a young man from Ethiopia, and he and his family often spoke Amharic, and it's really interesting to hear it spoken. This group is Christian. Their culture had just an enormous impact. And on the trip home, the guide changed his mind and let them stop for a minute and let Hancock speak with the people at the Falasha village. And they greeted him with shalom. And he found a guy who spoke English. And they showed him around the village. And the village of Weleka, and he said it was really dirty, lots of flies. These people were just in supreme poverty. Many thought that they had come to rescue them and take them to Israel. Many tried to sell him homemade, handmade clay souvenirs. He saw a lot of handmade crafts, pottery, weaving, clay bricks. He said that traditionally, the Amhara called manual workers tabib, one with the evil eye. So they really didn't like this Jewish subculture. No one could read. No one could read Hebrew. They were selling schlock that they'd gotten from Israel, kind of like that made in China souvenir stuff. They were very poor, and the form of Judaism that they practiced was degraded. Hancock was disappointed. He had expected a higher culture, and he kept asking and researching about the Tabats, the Arks, and in an old Ethiopian church history, he found this one sentence. It is the Tabat which gives sanctity to the church in which it is placed. Finally, in the glossary, I found the word Tabat defined simply as the Ark of the Covenant. Okay, I'm almost at the end of this. In the British Museum, they actually have Tabats that were looted from the Ethiopian churches during the Napier expedition to Magdala in the 19th century. They stole them and brought them home. They were stored away by the museum caretaker, and the caretaker showed him. I felt a thrill of excitement as he opened it. Inside, however, there was nothing that bore even the remotest resemblance to my image of the Ark. Separated by sheets of crepe paper, there were 9 wooden slabs, some square, some rectangular, none exceeding 18 inches in length and width, and none more than 3 inches thick. The majority were very plain, but all bore writing, which he recognized as Ge'ez, the ancient liturgical language of Ethiopia. I asked the caretaker, some of them had crosses. I asked the caretaker to check his index. Could he possibly have made a mistake? He said, no, these are your Tabats, all right, from the Holmes collection, brought back by the British expedition to Abyssinia, 1867 to 1868. So that's the end of that, Hancock thought. This whole story's wrong. I might as well give up. But he doesn't, because next we're going to do part 2. So I'll stop here, I'll upload this, and we'll start part 2. I'm racing the daylight here, so thank you very much for watching. I hope if you're a new subscriber, you're enjoying this book as much as I did. I just love this book. So for the moment, slán go foil, or, you know, shalom.